Hey, how you doing? This is RJ. Today I'm going to step a little bit outside my comfort zone and talk primarily about art in comic books. Usually I talk about story and I have much more experience with story than with the art, but I think that both of them need to certainly be there and to complement each other in a really great comic book. That's what I've always said, that if you want a great comic, you have to have the story and the art pulling in the same direction. If you want to have a good comic, you know, not a great comic, you can have art and story which are sort of neutral towards each other, but you can never have a good or a great comic if your art and your story are at odds with each other. It just won't work. And the thing is about the art, well, I want to look at it directly and see if there are some earmarks of what makes great art, what makes necessary art for a comic book, and how the art, especially today in Marvel and other comics as well, but especially Marvel, is just failing the comic genre. Now, I would say, to me anyways, that there is a standard of beauty, all right? Beauty is not subjective. There are things which naturally human beings are attracted to and naturally human beings are repulsed by. Now, you could say that those things come from a variety of different sources. You could say it's just instinctual. You could say it's just biological. You could say it's metaphysical. You could say it's philosophical. It doesn't matter. But I think that most of us would agree that there is a standard that human beings are attracted to, and there's a standard that human beings are repulsed by. And so beauty is not all in the eye of the beholder. That would be my first supposition. But I would also say that in comic books, you need to have a certain kind of art. And you just have to look at the definition of what we are examining, which is a comic book. You know, it has to be something which is a little bit different than reality. Comedy and your comic is something that is sort of a parody of reality. It's not exactly reality. And that's why we have drawings in comic books. And that's why it works in comic books. It's not exactly reality. That would be your first basis, if you ask me. And secondly, we're looking at superhero comic books. And the thing about superhero comic books is that the next thing that comes up in the line is, after comic, superhero. So it's a fantasy. So you have to have fantastical elements in it. And your story is fantastical, and your art also needs to have a fantastical element in it. I think that's a necessity. It needs to be there. But here's where I think the problem arises from. You have people like Marvel right now. They're trying to draw in a female audience. Now, whether or not they're trying to replace their male audience with a female audience, they might be trying to do that as well. But at the very least, at the absolute minimum, they're trying to draw in a female audience as well. And this has been stated a number of times by people like Sana Amanat. You know, they're trying to bring in girls. Especially when they're talking about Marvel Rising all the time, they're always talking about bringing in girls. They say, we already have the boys, we want to draw in the girls as well. And here's where the crux of the problem lies. Because the male and the female, your men and your women, your boys and your girls, they use the visual differently. There are different kinds of things which appeal to men than to women, visually. And that's not just me. I mean, men are very much more a visual creature than women are. There have been empirical studies, scientific studies about this that show that yes, men are much more attracted by the visual than women are. That's why men go towards comic books traditionally and women go towards novels traditionally. That's what happens. So men are primarily attracted to that visual. But at the same time, it's also been shown empirically through science that men, boys, even children as little babies, you have your male child, which is attracted more towards the mechanical, and you have your females, which are attracted to human faces. That just happens automatically, naturally. I mean, it's been proven scientifically. And the thing is that with men and boys, we have this ability, I would say, to put those two things together. Since we are attracted primarily by the visual, and our visual also includes being attracted to things mechanical, we can draw out, I would say, the matrices, the rules of things from the visual, even though they're not human, even though they have a very fantastical element to them. You know, and that's why I would say you can have a number of different great kinds of comic art, and they can be very, very different, but your males will be able to draw out the matrices of the rules of that art and apply them in a way that is easily understood by the male mind. You can say that, you know, I can draw out the rules from this because, again, men are attracted to the mechanical. You can look at a circuit board or something else and figure out the rules and be more mechanically inclined to be able to pick out what is going on much more readily. But when you have a female, you know, they take their cues from, again, human faces. They take their cues from body language, things like that. And with the female, if they're taking their cues of understanding much more from faces and the way that people express themselves, they need their visual to be much more, I wouldn't say simplistic, but realistic. And so I would say there are two different kinds of things which females would be attracted to in this kind of comic book art. One would be the cartoony, and the other would be the hyper-realistic. Now, somebody might say, well, isn't cartoony just very, very fantastical? I would say no, because again, you have cartoony, which I would say is supposed to be cutesy. That's where it comes from. You have this idea of cutesy, and we know, again from science, that cutesy is something that actually is a biological thing inherent in mammals and was put there for a survival technique. You know, you have your much, much older species, like, we'll say, crocodiles. You know, they're born just like a tiny little crocodile. They don't have any cutesy features to them when they're very small, and the mother crocodile will eat the tiny little crocodiles if they come in contact with them. It doesn't matter. So they develop different ways of dealing with having the young being born. But with mammals, you know, you have your child, which is born, got to stay with the mother because it has to feed off of the milk. Therefore, the mother has to have something, an innate, a instinctual attraction towards that child to make sure that they stay safe. And the thing that developed was you have a cutesy little child. And it happens in all mammals. You have this child which appears with these big puppy dog eyes and stuff like that, so that the adults will look at them and say, ah, I better protect that thing. And so in the female, again, that drive is very much included in, we'll say, the DNA of a woman, right? So they are attracted very much to the cutesy, and they are attracted very much to the hyper-realistic. The cutesy, because it speaks to something within motherhood, and the hyper-realistic, because it speaks to something within them where they can more easily draw out what is going on from the visual cues of human faces and human interaction. Whereas for your men, they can draw out the same level of understanding from things which are much more mechanical. And herein lies the problem, because for your men, it doesn't matter what kind of art you have, you can still draw out that kind of understanding from that art. But for your women, you need one of those two things, I would say. You would need either the cutesy or you'd need the hyper-realistic. And both of those things, the cutesy and the hyper-realistic, they are at odds with the fantastical. And a comic, which needs to be drawings, and a superhero comic, which needs to be fantastical, and you have a story which is already fantastical, and to have a good or a great story, the fantastical of the art has to add or support the fantastical story by being fantastical in itself. If you replace the fantastical in the art with something that is either cutesy or hyper-realistic, you cancel out that fantastic, which is necessary for a good superhero comic. And that's what is happening within comics, especially with Marvel comics. It's being replaced by art that's either 3D models in the background and the foreground, because you have this hyper-realistic visual that's coming through, and they're putting it there because they want to attract more women. And this is not just me speaking. This is Sana Aminad saying, you know, we went to this specific Japanese animation company so that they could put in more realistic facial features and body features, because they're known for that, so that we can attract more girls and women. Specifically, that's what they're saying. And that is at odds with the fantastical of the medium itself. That's the thing. And I would say here's what's going on. The problem is this. In a former time, when comics were doing well, they would say to themselves, okay, we're doing well. We have a predominantly male audience. No problem. We want to make more money. Let's attract some females. How do we do that? We'll produce some cutesy comics, like some Archie comics or some romance comics, and it will attract the females, and then we will either have cutesy or hyper-realistic in your romance comics, and it will attract that female audience, and those comics will be for the females. Whereas we'll keep the traditional superhero comics for the males, and that's what would happen. But you can't do that today, because if someone from Marvel came out and said, well, we want to make comics for women, we got to put out romance comics, they would get jumped on so fast and driven out of the industry by everyone around them that their head would spin and not know what's going on by the time they're out on the street. It just can't happen that way anymore. And again, you have people like Sana Amanat saying over and over again that superheroes can be for girls, you know. You know, she pushes that out there a lot, and saying things like she did in her last podcast, where she said that there's this idea out there that these kinds of superhero stories don't actually mix with the feminine. And the point is, she's actually right. They don't actually mix with the feminine that well. And this is what's killing their comics right now. Because if you want to actually attract the female, you have to actually realize there's a difference between the male and the female, that they look at things differently, that they understand things differently, and that they are visually attracted to different kinds of stories and different kinds of art. It just happens that way. But with the kinds of feminism that's driving everything today, and I would say even the initial feminism that originally came out in the early 1900s, it was all predicated upon this idea of getting rid of the man-woman divide. That is to say, that there's any difference whatsoever between men and women. That was one of their fundamental principles. And it's really become something that's ingrained in almost the society now, not just feminism, to say that there are differences between men and women and that they're equal but different, you'd get stoned. But it's really biologically true. We have scientific evidence to prove that this is true. And yet, they will not listen to such things because, again, they don't believe in anything outside of themselves. They're trying to impose their social ideas even upon reality itself. And this is what's going on. Since they can't go back to that good times where we produce comics for women themselves, which are either cutesy or hyper-realistic, and they are for the women, and we have ones that are for the men or for boys, then since they can't do that, they're trying to shove all of these things into the comics which are attractive to women themselves to draw in that new audience. And in doing so, they're canceling out the fantastical, which needs to be there, and in doing so, they are working contrary to the genre itself because it's superhero comics. The super part necessitates the fantastical, both within the story and the art. And they're working against that, and it's driving away all of their male audience. Because for a man, of course, this hyper-realism is working against your fantastical. They don't need this hyper-realism. They're looking at it either at the cutesy part or the hyper-realistic part and going, this is ridiculous. Why does everything look like either it's a cartoon for a two-year-old or it's just a copy of a photograph? Neither of these things work for me to actually enjoy the fantastical. And I think that's what's going on, especially with Marvel and with your comic books today. That's why you have art that looks like it does. Because, again, you have these women who are editors for Marvel. It's not that they don't know what they're doing. They know exactly what they're doing. This is the kind of art they want to push. This kind of art that we see in things like Squirrel Girl or Daredevil, you know, where you have a traced copy of a whole bunch of buildings and people. It either has to be one or the other, because that's what they're visually attracted to, and they're trying to write a comic or edit a comic or draw a comic that is going to be attractive to women. And it's killing the genre because, again, as I said, it's just contrary to the whole idea of the fantastical. So tell me what you think about my idea. Leave me a comment and tell me what you think, because honestly, I'm going out on a limb a little bit with this one, going out into the artistic, which I'm not entirely comfortable talking about. So leave me a comment. Tell me what you think. And if I gave you anything new to think about, hit like. Hit the shield in the lower right-hand corner of your screen to subscribe. All right. I'll see you later. Bye.